We will now begin recording the interview with Sandip and Dipak. The recording takes place on the 17th of February at Radio Cardiff, and the volunteer present is Lara Taffer, and this recording is being collected as an oral history and will be part of the Chronicle Project, a project led by VCS Cymru and funded by the Heritage Lottery Fund. So Dipak, can we start with you? Would you introduce yourself?
Yeah. My name is Dipak Kundo, and I have been with this group in Cardiff, it's called Wales Puja Committee, since 1978. So from that point, you know, sort of been involved in doing lots of things for this group, you know, organizing events or helping other people out in you know, sort of sorting out the finances and talking to people outside the group, representing the group in the, you know, as a, to outside bodies and things like that. So I'm pretty happy that I was involved with this group. And the group has, I think, you know, sort of got stronger and stronger over the years. It's a very small group, but I think our activity has been, you know, in the beginning it was limited, but then we you know, delved into other areas of activities, and we are pretty well known now around the communities we live in here.
Sandip, would you introduce yourself?
I'm Sandip Raha. I'm a hospital medical doctor. I actually work in Bridgend, but I did live in Cardiff from 1980 to 1996, and then I moved to Bridgend. But I'm very much involved with Welsh Puja Committee, which is a registered charity mainly for Indian and group, completely voluntary. And I have been associated with this organization since 1990. I'm the current chair of that group. And we have been doing quite a few projects over the last 15 years, particularly other than our religious and social activities. And some of those projects have been funded by Arts Council of Wales. And recently we are in the middle of another project which is funded by Heritage Lottery Fund. And it's called Heritage of Clay Image Making and Durga Puja Festivals in South Wales. And we have been trying to capture the history and heritage of this festival being celebrated in Cardiff and South Wales for the last 43 years by our organization.
And could you tell me how you got involved with the Wales Puja Committee? How did you first hear about it?
For me, I think I came to Cardiff with a new job in 1978, and that was the first day of our Puja festival, and so I was searching for information about Puja. Durga Puja is like Christmas within the Christian community. It is so important to us. So I found one and I visited the Durga Puja being held very close to the city center, and I got involved from day one, and I just said, can I be of any help? And I started doing a little bit of help, offering help from that day. And I thought I could not get out of it yet.
What kind of tasks were you doing in the early days? What kind of events did you guys put on?
Yeah, particularly, you know, sort of we used to do Durga Puja mainly. Then we started doing Saraswati Puja. It's another worshiping of goddess of learning. And then we added Kali Puja later on. Those are the three events we have been organizing right from the beginning. And the other events were added on later when you could, you know, put the time and money and, you know, finding the interest of the other people.
What happens at the events?
What happens? Durga Puja is like, to us, I think, generally, you know, we believe, or I believe personally, it is a religious festival, all right, but it's much more important in a social point of view. In you know, sort of, we meet friends, you know, after a year or something, you know, from the last event, you know, and we just get new acquaintances all the time. So meeting people, to me, you know, sort of, is very important. Once a year, meeting new people and meeting the old friends, you know. It's very good to know them, things like that. It's kind of, it becomes nostalgic at a later stage.
How has the group, how has the group changed from the early days to when you first got involved to now? Is it a lot different, or are you doing some of the same things?
I mean, I first got involved in, I knew about the group in 1981, 82 when I was in Cardiff for a few years, and because I knew Dipak at that time and he got me introduced to the group. I went away from Wales and then came back in 1990 in Cardiff with my job, and then I got really involved with the group. He actually managed to get me into post or even a secretary within a few months of being a member of the group. And that was a lot of, learning curve for me.
And we could not let it, sort of good worker sort of get out of it, you know.
I mean, the group is totally and completely voluntary. We don't have any paid members, and they're all, most of us, almost all of us are professionals, either IT, accounts, business, medics, and we have full-time job, but we do this out of our interest, out of pleasure, out of greater social role.
Perhaps social needs as well.
Yeah, social role and social integration. And the way it has changed, back in 1990s, we used to do just three festivals, which are Hindu festivals. And Durga Puja, Dipak mentioned, it's an autumn festival for Hindus. It's celebrated in big way in eastern India and even all over India. And it's a worshipping of goddess Durga, who is incarnation of good, and it's a good over evil, win of evil, win of good over evil. And that is celebrated over a 5-day period as an autumn festival. And we have this 5-piece image, clay image, which we worship, as well as worshipping is very important, but the main event, main thing is the socializing for whole 5 days, particularly afternoon, evenings. We have cultural programs. Our members, their children, their friends, our family put on shows like dance, music, drama, and people enjoy entertainment. We have a lot of cooking done on the premises. We tend to feed over 300-400 people every day in that festival over 5-day period. And so as the years went by, the thing obviously grew more and more. And now with the social media, Facebook, WhatsApp, internet, and all everything else, we have quite a large number of people coming from South Wales, southwest of England, Midlands, over those 5 days. And
I think at this point, if I can mention that we got a large followers as well who cannot come to the event, but they are keeping in touch with us to know about the event, how did it go, and things like that.
They're on social media.
Yeah, it's quite a lot of people who could not come.
Mm-hmm.
And as we are doing these three festivals, the second one he mentioned about Saraswati Puja, which is Goddess of Learning, usually done in February, just 1-day event. And the third one was Kali Puja, is a goddess of power and destruction, to be honest, and creation. And that's done in late autumn, November, every year. And we used to do the all three events in Cardiff. But nearly 15 years ago, due to logistics of doing events in Cardiff for a whole 5 days and the cost involved, we moved to Caerphilly. We do it in Penriol Community Centre in Caerphilly.
It's over 20 years now.
Yeah. And we have probably round about 30 very active volunteers in our group, but there are more than 30 members. And those people, a lot of us take annual leave during that festival of 5 days. I have been taking annual leave for the last 20 years. And so that I can spend all my time during the festival in there. And that includes right from planning, decorating the hall, arranging the image, to cooking, shopping, entertaining people, keeping everything tidy and clean afterwards. It's quite a hard job. And actually, after our main event, Durga Puja, you feel like you need a holiday. Because you have been there since 8, 9 o'clock in the morning, till midnight. you may come home for an hour or two to get fresh and then go back again in the evening. We do it all out of pleasure, out of our own choice. You know, nobody forces us. With the three projects he started, but now in last 10 years, we have done lots of other projects. We have done melas.
It's more than that, I think.
Yeah, 15 years, isn't it? We have done melas, Indian mela, where it's sort of showcasing Indian food.
Like a street fair.
We have done three of them in St. David's Hall in Cardiff. And one of them we did in old library in Cardiff, which is Cardiff Story Museum now. And we have done other events like this clay image making event we are doing. This is the third time we are doing a clay image making, which involves planning, finding a venue, and then commissioning two artists from India, clay image makers, sculptors.
It's quite a hard job to organize things, you know. This is a question of choosing the right artist to do the work, and then getting paperwork sorted, and it's not an easy job. It's 2-3 people have to work really hard to formalize things and getting making sure that the visa can be obtained and things. We never had a problem yet, but you never know.
I mean, these artists, they are not sort of, they are artists in their own right. They are not run-of-the-mill clay image makers, like in Kumar Tuli is a part of Calcutta, where all these artists, some of the artists make clay images in hundreds, you know, during Durga Puja festival mainly. But these are exclusive artists, and they come here. We have to provide and arrange their accommodation for 4 weeks, and all they're looking after for 4 weeks, and they actually start and right from making a wooden frame first, then hay, clay, paper mache, then painting, decoration, and all those things, one layer by other. So the last project we had just was between May and July this last year, 2016.
June 14th to July 6th.
Yeah. And we have...
June 2nd to July 4th.
So almost a month.
Just about a month with a set time.
And then we did it in Butte Town History and Arts Centre in Butte Street. And then that image was transported to Cardiff Story Museum for display for 2 weeks. And then we worshipped that image in our autumn festival in October, just last October. And we're still going through that project, hasn't finished yet. Because what we thought in this project, which is funded by Heritage Lottery Fund, is we collect the history of this festival, how it started in Wales back in the 70s, as Dipak was mentioning, who were the people involved, talking to them, taking digital recording history from them, collecting all the old pictures, video clips, whatever, and archiving it. We are going to make a whole archive of that.
We are also trying to get some information of local people, how they feel about our project, how they feel about our festivals and things, because we don't have any bar. Everybody is welcome. Anybody can come in and join us.
I mean, we had in this project this year, we had three schools involved as well in Cardiff, Radar Comprehensive, Cardiff High, and Lanishan High. And the year eight and year nine students, art student, they came. We went to the school, that workshop, what is this festival is, what is goddesses, what is clay image making in India. And then those students came in our clay image making project, participated, drawing art, making small art objects with the artist present. And it has come off in a big way. So we had even Cardiff Metropolitan University, second year art students, they were involved, half a dozen of them. They actually came and participated hands-on while the clay image making was being made. And we are planning to launch a film this year, sometime in May, about the whole project, and including our partners. And we collected a lot of interviews. We are doing some evaluation of our project at moment. And we'll launch a film in May. Hopefully, we're planning to launch it in Chapter Art Centre in Cardiff on one afternoon. And sort of, so the project will finish by end of May. And then all the collections we are doing is being archived in People's Collection as well as website for accessing for anybody free of cost.
Sounds very exciting. Doing lots of cool things. Do you have any favorite memories of events you've put on? Or?
Loads of them. I think each of us has got loads of them.
You carry on what you say.
Does one stick out in your mind that you might be able to share with us?
Yes, lots of things, you know, I still can remember, oh God, funny ones or the normal ones, you know.
Yeah, funny ones are good too.
Also, all sorts of things I can remember, you know, sort of, we had one of the most funny one, it's a little bit on a sadistic point in it. We had a caterer, we ordered some foods from a caterer. And the caterer comes in at the door and said, until I get the check, the food is not coming in. It's very awkward position at that time because we didn't have the money to spend. Because we are collecting money from all the, you know, people are joining us, you know.
Come to eat the...
Yes, yeah. Who are visiting us, you know. At that point, we didn't have the money. So all I had to do, write a personal check to him to get the food in. And I never liked that thing, doing that. And we didn't mind, you know. If he needs to spend some money, he will spend from his pocket. I will do the same, and other members, you know. But the way he asked for it, you know, it hit me. It did hit me. He said, until I get the money, food is not going in. That was one of the very funny ones.
I mean, we have a couple of things which happens, like in our festival, particularly in the evening. We don't have an invite list. Any number can come turn up. So it could be one day in the evening could be 150 and next day in the evening could be 300. So how you cook for people, you don't know the number.
I was going to ask, how do you plan?
And so we have got difficult. A catering officer. We have got two catering officers, usually ladies. They're very capable. Before the event, we have a meeting, lots of meetings of our committees, planning numbers. We put, okay, it's Friday, Saturday, Sunday, so there'll be more people coming in the evening. So we'll do 300 or 400. And I remember one occasion when we actually cooked for 150 people in one evening. This was quite a few years ago. And by the middle of the evening, when the program was still going on, the whole hall was totally packed. You couldn't move. So, and that standing capacity is 300. So it was actually going across 300. So we actually panicked, and obviously our both catering officers, they disappeared in the kitchen. And because we do shopping for all the whole 5 days grocery, like rice, lentils, all the spices, oil, those sort of things, because all Indian cooking, all vegetarian, they had to use up next 2 days rations for one evening, and they managed to cook for another 150 people in a matter of 1 hour.
I think I feel proud about that, that we managed to cook in 1.5 hours extra food for about 125 to 150 people.
And people didn't know.
All the members, we all volunteers. Yeah.
And the people who were guests didn't know what has happened, is it? I mean, they just had the food.
Kept it under wraps?
Yeah, just had the food. So that was one thing. The other thing which really reminds me was related to one of our projects. The first time we did a clay image making project in Cardiff Library those days, Cardiff Story Museum now, Cardiff Old Library. We brought these two artists from India. We couldn't find any accommodation for them, so we had to book them in bed and breakfast in Newport Road. And they both went into bed and breakfast, and we booked them in and everything. And 2 days later, we asked them, they said, I don't think we can stay here, Dr. Raha, because we are not used to cooked English breakfast, you know, and we can't really eat that thing in the morning.
I even remember the name. It's the bread and breakfast place called Lynx.
Yeah.
L-I-N-X.
It's probably not in business anymore. Anyway, so in the end, we had to actually take them out from there and move them somewhere else. And even that also bread and breakfast it was. So eventually, we ended up buying takeaway Indian food for them and taking it to them.
And getting homemade food almost every night.
We had a rota of members, isn't it? Who's going to buy what?
Stop here.
May I ask you, what motivates you to volunteer with this organization?
I suppose it's the inner satisfaction to me, you know. I feel very nice, enjoyable, and recollect memories from back home. These are the small things, but it gives me a lot of pleasure to be part of it, talk to people and ask them this or that, you know, having a chit-chat or something, and enjoy the time while we're in the event, you know.
I mean, for me, one of the motivation, in addition to what Dipak just said, obviously that's there, but also to, we have now, you know, lived in this country, coming from India, more than we have ever lived in India, you know, and this is our home. But we want to sort of pass on some of the tradition and experience and knowledge we got to the next generation. And we have got younger members as well who have come from India maybe 5 years ago or 10 years ago. And they have also got new ideas, which helps, because our ideas, which comes from India, are probably 30, 40 years old. And the new generation's idea is much recent. But combination of that and passing on to the next generation, like when my kids were younger or Dipak kids were younger, they participated, so they have got some idea what the festival is about, and they can tell their kids maybe, and we have people bringing their grandchildren, and they're performing, they're dancing, they're singing on the stage, they're seeing the festival being done, image being made. So they have got some idea of tradition and what the heritage actually means in this situation. And that's actually big motivation for me to participate and try to pass that on, so that those generations also understand, because as you know, living in Western world like this is very difficult, because you're exposed to all sorts of stimulation and all sorts of media all the time, and it's very easy to forget your roots. So I think that's my main motivation.
Do you have any advice or words of inspiration for people to get involved in volunteering, be it your organization or just any organization? What would you say to young people today to urge them to volunteer?
I think I would say that get involved into these kind of events, to know other people and their background, their culture, so that you can mix with people with open mind. You learn from them and try to let them know what you are, what your background is, and things like that, so that the relationship between the communities we live in is much better.
Yeah, I think the volunteering opens a different aspect of your personality, your attitude towards society, and understanding of different types of people, different types of society, and multiculturalism. And without volunteering, it's very difficult to learn that. Okay, we've got social media, everything else to learn from, but when you actually experience that hands-on, face-to-face, is different. So I will certainly say that whatever time, it may be difficult for younger people with young family, but certainly there are certain stages in your life when you don't have young kids anymore. And or you haven't got kids, you are just, you know, single or alone, whatever. In those sort of situations, you got time. I think it's a great thing to do volunteering. And I certainly, I'm on the verge of my retirement coming now, but I certainly am already thinking about volunteering some other groups other than just this our Hindu community group, you know, a wider group of volunteering.
And if you had to define volunteering, how would you define it? It's a tough question, but
yeah, I think I will define it as you do something in totally open mind, you like doing, you have got enthusiasm of doing it, and you believe in it as well. So those are the way I would look at it as defined.
And you are not being paid for it.
Yeah, that itself is understood anyway. So,
mm. And how do you think volunteering for Wales Puja community has helped you get to know your community better, or to get to know the Cardiff community better, or South Wales community, or do you think it has?
I mean, we certainly initially, obviously, we've got a great community we know, which is our group of Wales Puja Committee, or people who come in Wales Puja Committee events and function. So that's one circle. A wider circle through our project, we have got to know a lot of people, from local people and local organizations. I know, like I mentioned about school, we mentioned about People's Collection of Wales or Wales for Peace, Cardiff Story Museum. We have got very close relationship with St. Fagan Museum. We have done project there as well. So, and their contact and their community, when we go and participate in workshop or their events, it actually opens up your door even bigger. And those actually have helped to open our eyes as well, rather than keeping ourselves just within the Indian community. I think that's how it has helped.
Is there anything that we didn't talk about that you'd like to add? Maybe how the organization got started? Did you all just have dinner one day and say we should?
I think I would ask other people to know about us, mm-hmm. you know, through all the archive materials, you know. If you're interested, we can be, you know, we can be available at any time for answering any queries they may have. But I would like them to read about us, know about us, so that community relationship is improved.
Yes, I mean, in terms of how it got started and things, obviously I wasn't there in the beginning, but obviously we collect all the information, have got quite a lot of information, and as it happens, it's always things start in somebody's house, 3-4 people talking about it, and let's do it. And initially, to be honest, even up to 25-30 years ago, I think most people who were involved actually forked out most of the money from their own pocket, you know, and the thing was much more smaller scale. And now we completely survive on people's donation, and we have people just give donation out of their good heart, and we don't have to, you know, twist their arms or anything. We just announce it and people donate. And I think the way it has developed and grown is because people who are involved want it to develop and grow. So that's the actual driving force.
Mm-hmm. I think in terms of donations, we don't have any fixed donations. It's completely voluntary. Mm-hmm. You don't have to give anything to us, and there is no minimum at all, you know. Some people can donate £1 even, you know, for any of the functions. So that's why the relationship is much more freer.
Have there been any frustrations or disappointments over the years?
Of course, we always have had some frustrations. You know, so say him and me, I think we would say the same if I can explain. Sometime we didn't have, you know, sort of more than 2 members working on the whole area of things we have to do before an event. But it is frustrating, believe me, you know, because everybody is, oh, I'm busy, I can't come down or something. Sometimes it can be quite frustrating. It's nobody's fault. It's just sometimes it can happen.
It's the nature of volunteering.
Yeah, it is. It is.
And I mean, if somebody has an emergency or any other something untoward turns up, I think one of the frustration is when you are actually planned yourself in a very articulate way and you arriving somewhere which needs to be done in time and nobody else is around and everybody's supposed to come at that time and you're waiting for them, but this is volunteering, so you can't really sell, it's not a job that you are going to pay it for. So you sometimes feel, why I am here, why nobody else is here, you
just
know?
Feeling,
and that sort of frustration does come on. But
feeling of let down, you know?
Yeah, but I think as we have grown in last, particularly last 10 years, we've got a lot of people who are sharing a lot of responsibility.
We've got slightly
lot
more
of responsibility.
Very willing volunteers, in numbers, you know, willing volunteers number of willing volunteers have grown in our group, which is a good sign for a group.
And also people, you know, younger people have come in who are good in media, social, IT, all sorts of things, which obviously is various important things for any organization these days. You know, you have to have those people. If we have to contract outside company for everything, then we won't be able to afford it. And this is all done voluntarily.
Do you have a hierarchy or a structure of how you organize your volunteers?
Yes,
in the work?
He can explain. He's the chairman of the group.
I mean, we have a constitution. We are a registered charity. Our constitution is around about 22, 23 years old now. And we have a trustee, board of trustees, and we have got an executive committee. And the executive committee meets, at least probably I'll say every 6-8 weeks. And nearer the events, when we have main festivals, it meets every month to plan for the event and everything. An executive committee is, chairman is there, there is a secretary, there's a treasurer, and then we have got entertainment officers and catering officers. We also got a media officer now. Like a public relation officer. And these are all formally elected by sacred ballot every year. But most of the time we have just one person, there is no election. But we still go through the formal process of nomination and ballot and all that. So it's very democratic way. And in any of our meeting, when we sit, if any new proposal comes, which discussed and not everybody agrees, we just have a count and votes on the show of hands. And everybody takes it very democratically. Even as a chairman, if I propose something and it's turned down, I won't feel hard about it. It's democratically done. So there is a full structure for it.
Anything else you'd like to add?
No, I think we covered most of the things.
Yeah. No, I think
yeah,
we covered
a lot
most of
the
things.
Questions that I have, you kind of answer
in some
within,
way.
Yeah, you answer that's without me sense. Having to directly oh. ask. So.
That's good.
Yeah.
Saved your time.
Good. Yeah. All right, well, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much for calling us.
Can we take this?
Absolutely.
Flips?